Well, hi, friends. Hey, the brother Mike back on the podcast on twitch.tv. And time for the deep things of God with brother Mike. Okay. Got another really good one for you today. Couple of quick reminders, of course. We have two live services every week at the Deliverance Center. We're on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road in the downtown area. It's the red brick building on Mulberry. You can't miss it when you go down 15th Avenue there. Try it at the bus stop. Two live services every week. Brother Rick and kills it on Thursday night. If you haven't been taking advantage of his services, that's a big mistake. He knows more about demons than 10 YouTube guys added together. It's quite remarkable. Very knowledgeable. I usually teach on Friday nights, so we're all on YouTube. You just go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz, and you're on our YouTube broadcasts every Thursday and Friday night live. We're on a couple other platforms as well. Please remember, we have a counseling center there for born-again Christians. If you're a born-again Christian, you can come for free counseling services. No insurance necessary. 602-636-5800. Give me a call and I'll get you on the counseling schedule ASAP. Please remember our Zoom services. They've got massive anointings on both of them. Ladies, 6:30 Monday nights with Julie and the gang. I believe Jennifer's there too. Wednesday nights, Stephanie and Rick. Just remarkable, remarkable Zoom service. I'm telling you, I tuned in there one time. I popped in and there were like 40 people going through deliverance all at once. I mean, it was huge. So that's something that, you probably need to avail yourself of for sure. For sure. In addition, we have children's deliverance services. We've got another one coming up in July, next Saturday, the 13th, at 10 o'clock, pre-teens. If you have a preteen who needs to be prayed for and delivered, you have to be at these services. Please bring them before Satan gets them. 10 o'clock, Saturday the 13th. We also have women's seminars. We also have quarterly healing services. The last one we had with Peter Valenzuela, spectacular. That was last Saturday night, really impressive. So, there's lots of great things going on at the Deliverance Center. If you need help, you can get it there for free. If you go to Luke chapter 7, you'll see a remarkable story. And what we know about the Holy Ghost is this. When he puts a story in the New Testament and the Old, when he puts a story in the New Testament, it's a story designed to increase your faith and to establish markers in the road for your travel, your journey to miracles. And the purpose of these stories is to give you a roadmap on how to get a miracle. How do you actually get a miracle? This is how you do it. This is how you do it. Luke chapter 7. One of the Pharisees desired that Jesus would come have lunch with him. And this was Simon the Pharisee. And it says, and behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, she knew that Jesus was at Simon's house having lunch, it says in verse 38. She came there and brought with her her alabaster box. And she came there and she stood behind him. Now, what does that mean, standing behind him? Was he seated in a chair at a table? No, back in those days, people didn't have chairs and a lot of furniture in most homes. And because everybody walked everywhere and they were exhausted, what happened was everybody laid down when they ate. And it says that she came up behind him while he was laying down. And she started weeping and her tears started to fall on his feet. And so what she did was she unwrapped her hair. And back in those days, women didn't cut their hair. They kept it up in buns. And if you pulled the pin out, their hair would like fall down like 4 or 5 feet. So she pulled out her hair and she started to clean off his feet with her hairs. And then after she cleaned off his feet, she started kissing his feet. And it says she brought some ointment. Greek word is myron. That was a very, very expensive oil-based perfume from Italy. It was imported and it was extremely expensive. And what looks like in this verse is that it appears that this woman was a prostitute because she was mentioned as a sinner. Everybody's a sinner, but this woman was mentioned as an outstanding, hardcore sinner. She was a nasty sinner. So my guess is this was a prostitute. And because she had moron, which is what prostitutes only broke out for their best Johns, the ones that paid the most money, usually people of note or people of high society, they would come to prostitutes and they had money to pay. And so they would break out the moron, the special ointments and the perfumes for their high-priced Johns. And when Simon the Pharisee saw verse 39, he started thinking in his mind. It says he spoke within himself. The Holy Spirit is omniscient, so he knows what everybody's thinking 100% of the time. But here Jesus, after he had emptied himself, he was no longer omniscient, but he had the gifts of the Spirit running at maximum capacity. So he had the gift of knowledge higher than anybody's ever had it. And it says he could see their thoughts. Jesus knew what Simon was thinking. And Simon said, listen, if this man were a prophet, he said, if he was questioning his authority and questioning whether or not he was a prophet, every time you see an if there, you can either go this way or that way on an if. I taught a Bible study on that just a couple of weeks ago. If then. Be worth you taking a look. Well, if he were a prophet, he would have known what manner of woman this is. Patapas is what kind of a person she is. Well, she was a whore. She was a prostitute. And she's touching him. Simon the Pharisee couldn't believe this, that a scumbucket human being like this woman, A, came into his house. Okay, he didn't do anything about it because Jesus was there. So he wanted to put up a front of his piousness, whatever the term is. I just made that up. He wanted to keep that front up. And translation, he goes to church. That's what happens when you go to church. Everybody kind of puts on their best God face when they're in church. And the person you're talking to at church is not really that person. That's just a social construct, almost like AI. He said, my God, he ought to know what kind of a piece of garbage is touching him. She's actually touching him. And on top of that, she was kissing his feet. On top of that, she brought out moron, which is an extremely expensive perfume that Simon the Pharisee recognized probably because he'd probably been to her. So as you can imagine, several other people there in the room had also been to this prostitute. I mean, everybody's nerves were on edge. When this woman walked in, it took more courage than Moses splitting the Red Sea to walk into that house that day, knowing what everybody thought of her and how critical they were of her and knowing her status in society. she was at the bottom of the barrel, with the exception of tax collectors. They were at the bottom, but just above that, whores. And Jesus says to Simon, because he was reading his thoughts, he said, Simon, I want to ask you a question. And Simon goes, Master, say on. The Greek word master there is didaskalos. It means teacher. So Simon did not think he was a prophet at all, but he thought he was some itinerant teacher roaming around teaching people. So he used the term teacher. And Jesus said, listen, there was a couple of creditors. There was a creditor with a couple of debtors. And he said they owed him a bunch of money. One of them owed him 500 denarii. That was a coin, small coin about the size of a quarter, denarii. And the other one owed him 50 denarii, which by our standards today was very little money. And Jesus said, look, both of them were broke, and neither of them had anything to pay. They couldn't pay anything. And he asked Simon, look, the creditor decided to have mercy on both of them. And he just forgave them their debt. He forgave this one 500 denarii, and forgave that one 50. And then Jesus asked him a question. He said, which of them will love him the most? Now that's a Greek word, agapao. It's a Greek verb, not a noun. Agape is the noun. Agapao is the verb for agape, and it means to show love to someone. And Jesus said, which of these two debtors do you think would show love more to the creditor? And Simon said, well, I suppose the one that was forgiven 500. And Jesus said, that's the correct answer. Thank you. You got it. Okay? You got the right answer. And then it says, verse 44, he turns around. Greek word strepho means to bend backwards. He looks backwards at the woman at his feet. And he says to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears. She wiped them down with her hair. Now, what was he saying there? Well, back then, back in the day, it was customary. Everybody did it. When you had a guest come to your house, a stranger, the servants that lived in your house, they always washed their feet. They always wiped their feet clean because everybody walked everywhere and they all wore sandals. Sandals was a big business back then. Huge, you know, like Nike or something. Everybody wore sandals. And you took your sandals off and the host of the house just customarily did it for everybody. Wash your feet, clean your feet both. But you see, Simon didn't want to be seen doing that because he was afraid of peer pressure. And that's one of the things that destroys Christians, is peer pressure. They're always worried about what somebody thinks about them. It really bothers them. Well, he couldn't be seen washing Jesus' feet because this was a very controversial figure. He thought he was a prophet. Simon knew he wasn't. So the tension's mounting here. You know, it's very much like our tradition of shaking hands. Everybody has certain traditions, you know, like the Italians, they like to give kisses on the cheek when they greet somebody. Well, back then they would always wash your feet. And he says, look, you didn't give me any water and you had no one wash my feet. Verse 45. But he rolls back and he looks back at her and he says, see this woman, since I came in here, she has not stopped kissing my feet. Then he says, you didn't give me any oil for my head. That was another common custom of strangers or guests in their home. They would anoint them with oil. And he didn't even do that. But she anointed his feet. with the Muron, the very expensive ointment from Italy, imported. Costs a lot of money. Therefore, I say to you, Simon, now he rolls back and looks at Simon. Is I say to you that this woman's sins, which are many, which again leads me to believe she was a prostitute. She was a hardcore level one sinner. He says, this prostitute here has many, many, many sins. You see that? Those sins are forgiven for her. Greek word athemi, it means to release. When God forgives you of your sin, he releases you from it. Athemi, to release. Jesus looks at the girl and goes, your sins are released from you. Because he said she loved much, agapao, she shows much love, but those who are forgiven or released of little, they also show little love. They show little. He said the same loveth, agapao, shows love little. Oligos, a little bit, few. And he turns to the woman and rolls back and says, your sins are released from you. Athemi. Well, now Jesus stepped in it because that triggered a huge response. They all start thinking again. Well, Jesus had having the maximum gift of knowledge, saw them thinking, who is this, verse 49, that forgives or releases sins? Only God can do that. And he said to the woman, he ignores Simon's thoughts. He says to the woman, your faith has what? Saved you, sozo, delivered you. Go in Irene, peace, be at peace. Wow, what a story. Why is this story in the Bible? What's going on here? Well, God laid out a pattern for you on how to get a miracle from God. Now, you may not need to be forgiven. You may have already been forgiven. If you're a born-again Christian, you have. But you may need to be delivered from spirits. You may need to be healed. You may need a miracle in your finances. You may need a miracle in your family. Your family's out sinning or being oppressed by demons, or Satan is wreaking havoc somewhere in your life. There's all kinds of things you need to be sozo delivered from. And the Holy Spirit put this incredible story in the Bible right here in Luke. Why? To give you a pattern of how to get a miracle from God. Now, I want you to notice something. The worst person at that dinner was the prostitute. The best person at the dinner was the Savior of the world. Jesus didn't need to be forgiven of anything because he never sinned. She had done nothing but sin. She was a hardcore, nasty, filthy sinner. Level one sinner. But did you happen to notice that the religious people there, the folks from the church, not one of them got delivered that day? They were the church people, Pharisees. They were from the synagogue. They were righteous, religious people. None of them got forgiven. If you remember the story, I didn't finish reading it. The disciples, they freaked when they saw that woman doing that, because they said, hey, we should have sold this moron for a truckload of money and given it to the poor. We could have fed a whole bunch of poor people with this moron money. This stuff's expensive. It was probably her life savings, what it was. Similar to the widow with two mites, everybody brought their abundance into the treasury. And Jesus turned to his disciples and said, hey, see that widow there with two mites? That was a that was a coin, smallest of all coins, and the least valuable. It was only worth part of our penny, less than a penny. Jesus said, that woman there put in more than all the others, because she put in all she had. This woman that brought the muron brought her life savings. And she saw there was a chance she could be forgiven and get a miracle from God. Little did she know the Holy Spirit was going to record this story in the New Testament. And she was going to teach us how to get a miracle from God. How do you get a miracle from God? Well, you don't do it the way Simon tried it, being critical and listening to negative thoughts put in your mind by demons. That isn't going to get you a miracle. And then what else happened? The disciples freaked. They were critical and they were criticizing her. They didn't get any miracles. Now, how in the world can everybody in the synagogue not get a miracle? And everybody at the church not get a miracle? And the disciples not get a miracle? How can that happen? How can a prostitute be the only person among the whole group that day that got delivered sozo? Now, how in the world can that be? The last shall be first, the first shall be last. Well, the way it works is this. You have got to come to God in desperation. And you have to follow her steps. Her step one was desperation. She wanted a new life. She had been a whore for years. She couldn't take it anymore. She was loaded with demons. She needed a miracle. She wanted to be saved. She knew she was going to hell. She came in desperation for a miracle from God. Number two, courage. This woman showed more courage than Moses did at the Red Sea. Walking into that room with everybody's eyes on her, and all the eyelids were critical of her, took more courage than you can even imagine. Three, she brought everything she had. Her life saving was wrapped up in that alabaster box and that muron. And she brought it and gave it to Jesus, just like the widow with two mites. The reason most people can't get a miracle is because they're not desperate enough to go for it. They're not desperate enough to push their way through. They don't care enough. They're busy with a pity party, you know, low self-esteem, self-disgust. They're too busy with poor me to look at the great gift of God, which is a theme to release you from your sins, your sickness, from demons, from whatever it is. All that's covered in the gospel. All of it. The woman was desperate. She didn't care what anybody thought about her. She pushed her way through in the face of criticism and negativity. She broke into the miracle division of heaven. And that's why most Christians can't get a miracle. They don't follow the pattern the Holy Spirit laid out for them. Would you do that today? I told you about the Holy Spirit last week on the podcast. Remember, the fight is fixed. Well, today, your fight will fix this mess. You're going to press your way in the face of adversity and criticism. You're going to get to Jesus no matter what you have to do, and you're going to win, just like she did. Woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. See you next time.